A few weeks ago, I spoke to you with a title called Profiles in Courage. And we looked at courage in the Bible through the lens of, you know, one of the best ways to learn, and that is through the stories of some people that brought us courage. If you were here, you would have heard us talk about Jonathan and his armor bearer as our Bible story. And you would have heard us talk about Jim Elliott, a Portland native who represented courage for us as a recent historical figure. And then you would have heard about a lady, and I can't say her name off the top of my head, but you would have heard about the courage that's going on today of Christians who are in prison and demonstrating their faith through courage to spread the gospel even in prison. And the lady is from Eritrea. She's there right now, but she represents many, many. Today is maybe kind of it's not the same message. It's titled Profiles in Courage. Thank you. It's titled Profiles in Faith. And again, it's illustrated through stories, not just through single individuals. And at least one of them is a very short story or some words about a famous person. They're all stories I think that you know to some degree, maybe know very well. But I hope there's some deep lessons and deep reminders of things that you know that will feed your souls this morning. And it's not spoken in the same way. It's not just me. I'm so thankful for my wife to be part of the message team this morning to help share this message with you. So if you can, if you'd bow your heads, I'm going to kneel and have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for the sermons that we've already received through the children's story, through the special music, through praise and petition time. We ask now again that your Holy Spirit will be here as we look at profiles in faith. And may these not just be stories, but may there be a living reality for us of faith as we study the subject. In Jesus' name, amen. The first story, so I've got three stories, and they're going to be chronological. First one is going to be a little bit shorter. There's many examples to choose from. So faith, there's many examples to choose from. So it's easy to pick, but I hope these particular choices are a blessing to you. The first of the choices comes from the Hall of Fame chapter. Now in our scripture reading, Rosie read from the Hall of Fame chapter. On faith. Did I say courage again?
No, you said Hall of Fame.
The Faith Hall of Fame. The Faith Hall of Fame is Hebrews chapter 11. That's the Faith Hall of Fame. The first character is in that Faith Hall of Fame. His name's Joseph. You know the story of Joseph well, but there's something before, and just a few images to illustrate this story of Joseph and some quotes. That's all I have, and we'll move on. But one of the things I want you to think about Joseph and faith, think about if you were to be in prison for your faith today, what are some of the things that you could draw on from your faith today? Well, you could draw on the story of Joseph. Promises, a Bible chock full of promises. You could draw on the teachings of Jesus. You could draw on music that you've heard. You could draw on maybe some quotes from the Spirit of Prophecy, some illustrations she brings out about the lives of Esther, Daniel, Mary, you name it. On and on and on and on. As we look at the life of Joseph, what was he drawing on with what he went through? He was drawing on early teachings. But the scripture that he would have had would have just been the scripture of oral tradition. Or I shouldn't say tradition. Just been the scripture as given to him orally. Moses being the first one to pen it down. What stories was he drawing on? There was no, well, he did have the story of Jacob and the angel, his own father. So he might have had that. Definitely would have had that.
Abraham,
the stories of Abraham. Noah. So he had those. He did have some wonderful stories. He didn't have the stories of Daniel or the three Hebrews. He had the example of Abel. So he did have some very key examples in the Bible. But there's more that devolves, as history has gone on, there's more that devolves upon us to learn these lessons of faith from people that have gone before. I have, the pictures I have, I like pictures. Like a lot of us like pictures and stories. And so I just, two pictures, the one of them on the left, there's an interesting documentary that we've seen recently and maybe a handful of you have seen here. The image on the left is a modern image, but it is illustrated from a very ancient image that's been excavated that there's a good argument that some people have that it does indeed represent the real character of Joseph, not just... So the colors are modern, but there's some evidence that might represent Joseph. Yes, John? And yes, it's from an empty tomb that's very suspicious. I'll just put it that way. And over on the right is a very, very large storage facility, something I found online. So both of these images from the, we all love the happy endings, from the successful, wealthy Joseph with the wife and two kids, or maybe he had more, but two sons, and from that time in his life, that might be one of the granaries that Joseph had built to store grain. It is an ancient storage facility in Egypt. Faith through prison, not seeing the future. We know the end of the story. I want to remind you in this profile of faith. Joseph, faith to do right even when you suffer. You know that the story of Joseph ends up right, and we like stories about that. And indeed, if you are a Christian, the ultimate story of the Great Controversy does end up right. And your life, Jesus is inviting you to put yourself in a position where your life ends up right. But Joseph shows us the story of a man who did right, even chose to do right, even when he knew he was going to get in trouble for choosing to do right. That's what I want you to think about Joseph today. The image I had, I found a worse image actually, but I didn't want to put up here. It was so gruesome looking. So this is a museum of a prison in Vietnam. I believe it's Hanoi. If you were a prisoner of war in Vietnam, you might have your feet in something like Joseph had to endure, at least some of the time. And some quotes here. Joseph knew well the consequence of resistance. This was a great temptation that he was faced with. On the one hand were concealment, favor, and rewards. On the other, disgrace, imprisonment, perhaps death. His whole future life depended on the decision of one moment. You may know, I hope you know the story. He was invited to commit adultery. He was told to commit adultery. His whole life, has your whole life depended on a decision before? It actually may have. Maybe you don't realize it right now, but your life may have. For any one of us, our whole future life can swing on the decision of a moment, and that's what happened with Joseph. Look at the last sentence there. Isn't it amazing to realize that angels enter into the great controversy in every one of our lives? They're not just some beings out there that are vaguely aware that there's a world in rebellion. No, they know Ralphie. They know her. They know me. They know Norma personally. And angels were looking on during Joseph's temptations. It says with inexpressible anxiety, the angels looked on the scene. The angels didn't know what was going to happen next. They were full of anxiety. Angels never knew anxiety before sin entered the world, but now they know what anxiety is like. Joseph's answer reveals the power of religious principle. How can I do this great wickedness and sin against God? Let the young ever remember that wherever they are and whatever they do, they are in the presence of God. No part of our conduct escapes observation. To every deed, there is an unseen witness. Every act, every word, every thought is as distinctly marked as though there were only one person in the world to keep track of. I added the keep track of there. But as if there was just one person, everyone is marked. Joseph suffered for his integrity in choosing to do right. Joseph expressed a faith and a courage, they go together, to see himself through to an end that he did not fully know. He had the faith to do what was right without knowing the bookend of the story that we know. The Bible tells us, Moses tells us in this particular psalm that Moses wrote, he sent a man before them, Joseph, who was sold as a slave. They hurt his feet with fetters. He was laid in irons until the time that the word came to pass. The word of the Lord tested him. Joseph's our first profile in faith. I'm going to invite Teresa up here to give us a story of faith that was challenged. Okay. I'm going to give it a little introduction. The faith of the disciples was tried at Capernaum. I like maps and pictures and story. I like maps with my pictures and stories. So there's a map for you of the Sea of Galilee. On the northern end, just to the western end, you see the town of Capernaum that our story is going to be centered in today. And there's several of the famous Bible stories of Jesus happened in the center of the Gospels happened in really close time frame, close sequence with each other. So in close sequence, this story is backed up by John the Baptist having just been executed. This is in about the first year of Jesus' ministry. John the Baptist has been executed. The disciples are to come away. Multitudes find him. The 5,000 are fed. They want to make Jesus king. He sends them away. His disciples spend a night on the lake. Jesus meets them. Peter walks on the water. Jesus lands. People come to Jesus and get healed. All of these stories, if you compare Matthew and John, are happening right together. Boom, 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 boom. So shortly after Jesus has fed the 5,000 and crossed to the other side of the lake, some miracles are performed, and then people meet Jesus, and some faith is sorely tested.
I'd like to invite you to turn in your Bibles to John chapter 6, and we're going to read this story. It's actually a little bit lengthy, so I'm wondering, honey, if we could go back and forth a little bit with the reading. You could come up here.
Yes, absolutely.
Okay. So we're actually going to read the whole thing, and then we're going to go back and talk about it. So John chapter 6, we're going to start in verse 22. And honey, maybe you could come up and read the words of Jesus, and I'll read the other words.
Sure.
Okay. Starting John, verse 22 of John 6. The day following, when the people stood on the other side of the sea, saw that there was none other boat there, save that one whereinto his disciples were entered, and that Jesus went not with his disciples into the boat, but that his disciples were gone away alone. Howbeit, there came other boats from Tiberias nigh unto the place where they did eat bread after that the Lord had given thanks. When the people therefore saw that Jesus was not there, neither his disciples, they also took shipping and came to Capernaum seeking for Jesus. And when they had found him on the other side of the sea, they said to him, Rabbi, when camest thou hither? And Jesus answered them and said,
Most assuredly, I say to you, you seek me, not because you saw the signs, but because you ate of the loaves and were filled. Do not labor for the food which perishes, but for the food which endures to everlasting life, which the Son of Man will give you, because God the Father has set his seal on him.
Then they said unto him, What shall we do, that we might work the works of God? Jesus answered and said unto them,
This is the work of God, that you believe in him whom he has sent.
They said therefore unto him, What sign showest thou then, that we may see and believe thee? What dost thou work? Our fathers did eat manna in the desert, as it is written, He gave them bread from heaven to eat. Then Jesus said unto them,
Most assuredly I say to you, Moses did not give you the bread from heaven, but my Father gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is he who comes down from heaven and gives life to the world.
Then they said they unto him, Lord, evermore give us this bread. And Jesus said unto them,
I am the bread of life. He who comes to me shall never hunger, and he who believes in me shall never thirst. But I said to you that you have seen me and yet do not believe. All that the Father gives me will come to me, and the one who comes to me I will by no means cast out. For I have come down from heaven not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. This is the will of the Father who sent me, that of all he has given me I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day. And this is the will of him who sent me, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day.
The Jews then murmured at him because he said, I am the bread which came down from heaven. And they said, Is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How is it then that he saith, I came down from heaven? Jesus therefore answered and said unto them,
Do not murmur among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent him draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall all be taught by God. Therefore, everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone has seen the Father, except he who is from God. He has seen the Father. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who believes in me has everlasting life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate manna in the wilderness and are dead. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that one may eat of it and not die. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I shall give is my flesh, which I shall give for the life of the world.
The Jews therefore strove among themselves, saying, How can this man give us his flesh to eat? Then Jesus said unto them,
Most assuredly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever eats my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. For my flesh is food indeed, and my blood is drink indeed. He who eats my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so he who feeds on me will live because of me. This is the bread which came down from heaven, not as your fathers ate the manna and are dead. He who eats this bread will live forever.
These things said he in the synagogue as he taught in Capernaum. Many, therefore, of his disciples, when they had heard this, said, "This is an hard saying. Who can hear it?" When Jesus knew in himself that his disciples murmured at it, he said unto them,
"Does this offend you? What then, if you should see the Son of Man ascend where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life, the flesh profits nothing. The words that I speak to you are spirit, and they are life. But there are some of you who do not believe."
For Jesus knew from the beginning who they were that believed not, and who should betray him. And he said,
"Therefore I have said to you that no one can come to me unless it has been granted to him by my Father."
From that time, many of his disciples went back and walked with him no more. Then said Jesus unto the 12,
"Do you also want to go away?"
Then Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom shall we go? Thou hast the words of eternal life, and we believe and are sure that thou art that Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus answered them,
"Did I not choose you 12, and one of you is a devil?"
He spake of Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon, for he it was that should betray him, being one of the 12. So thank you for hanging with us through that long reading. It's almost impossible to put our minds back into the place where the disciples would have been. But remember that the whole common conception of the Messiah was that of earthly greatness. That's what everyone had been taught from childhood up. And Jesus' teaching had created this wonderful buzz and excitement, and the crowds and the 5,000 had been fed. And there was a great expectation of earthly reward. And then in John 6, the disciples, they hung on to Jesus, but almost everyone left him. It's hard to put ourselves in that position, but I think we need to try to do that, to learn the lessons, because we are going to come to a place where we'll be in a very similar situation. I'd like to look at just a few of the lessons from John 6. One is motivation. Did you notice that the crowds came to find Jesus because of this earthly expectation and reward, and Jesus didn't waste a moment? He got right to the heart of the issue. So what was their motivation in looking for Jesus? Most people's motivation in looking for Jesus?
Food.
Yes, it was hope of earthly reward, of blessing. And there were the curiosity seekers. Oh, there's a big event going on. Let's go see what the excitement is. But Jesus got right to the issue in verse 26. He said, "You do not seek me because you saw the miracles, but because you did eat of the loaves and were filled." And I have to say, I hope I'm learning my lesson. The Lord's trying to teach me this too. As the moms group on Adventist Home is reading through, we've learned that the country is the place to be raising our children where it's possible. And She says, in Adventist home, even if it's a financial sacrifice, you lose money, go to the country to raise your children if you can. Finances is not our number one goal in this world. It's service. It's service. Well, notice their next question the crowd asks. So Jesus said, well, okay. I mean, the crowd says, okay, we shouldn't be after this earthly goods, these earthly goods, so what can we do to earn it? What can we do? What can we do? So it's a works-based religion that they were after. And Jesus is the price of heaven. It's not something that we can earn. It's something that Jesus has paid for. Why was Jesus rejected? He didn't fit their expectations. Their expectations were that I am going to benefit by associating myself with Jesus. I am going to receive benefit. And definitely the disciples did receive benefit, but it wasn't what they were expecting. They received a lot of persecution. So then the rabbis, half mockingly, are asking Jesus, well, then what sign are you going to give us? He had just fed that 5,000 people. What were they focusing on? They were focusing on the physical, the careers, the homes, the finances, power, buildings. But Jesus was offering something very different. He wasn't offering necessarily that job promotion or that financial break in your life. What he was offering was a new heart, a new life. He was offering character transformation. He was offering to take that old ragged, oily shirt off of Raphael and to replace it with something beautiful. Jesus, when he was on this earth, he was not an earthly king. He was a servant, even to the point of death. So, but somehow we get in our brains that if we follow Christ because God is love, then we should have these good things. And God does bless us with good things sometimes. But the most important thing that he wants to bless us with is character transformation. And that is the real richness and reward of the gospel. And that is why Jesus was rejected, is because people did not want selfishness to be uprooted. They wanted to do it their way and still get into the kingdom of heaven. And so we have to ask ourselves the question, how do we want it? Do we want it our way and to get into the kingdom of heaven? Or are we willing to just go God's way and to surrender everything? I want to read you just a couple of short little quotations from Desire of Ages when she's talking on this segment. This is the bottom of 389. She says, are you a follower of Christ? Then all that is written concerning the spiritual life is written for you and may be attained through your uniting yourself with Jesus. Is your zeal languishing? Has your first love grown cold? Accept again the proffered love of Christ. Eat his flesh. Drink of his blood, and you will become one with the Father and the Son. Praise God. Whatever situation that you're in spiritually, I know there have been times when I have been lagging, when I've been doubting, when I've been struggling, and I have to take that time to go back and study the Word of God, listen to Desire of Ages, And when you do that, that's the promise. We can be changed by God's grace. Isn't that exciting? Okay, two more quotations and then our final thought for this story on faith. This is page 391. By looking constantly to Jesus with the eye of faith, we will be strengthened. God will make the most precious revelations to his hungering and thirsting people. If we don't want it, we're not going to get it. They will find that Christ is a personal Savior. As they feed upon his word, they will find that it is spirit and life. What does the Bible do when we read it? It destroys the natural, earthly nature and imparts a new life in Christ. Christ had spoken a secret, eternal truth regarding the relation between him and his followers. All who received him would partake of his nature and be conformed to his character. And this involved the relinquishment of their cherished ambitions. It required the complete surrender of themselves to Jesus. The test was too great. Here's your quotation. Yeah. It is wholehearted, thoroughly decided men and women who will stand now. Christ sifted his followers again and again until at one time there remained only 11 and a few faithful women to lay the foundation of the Christian church. There are those who will stand back when burdens are to be borne, but when the church is all aglow, they catch the enthusiasm, sing and shout, and become rapturous. But watch them. When the fervor is gone and only a few faithful Calebs will come to the front and display unwavering principle, these are salt that retains the savor. It is when the work moves hard that the churches develop the true helpers. To be great in God's kingdom is to be a little child in humility, in simplicity of faith, and in the purity of love. So my question for each one of us is the test too hard? Will it be too hard when there's no church to attend? Perhaps. When our ambitions have to be given up, and when we see that following Jesus is an offer, yes, of eternal life, but it's a spiritual offer of giving up selfishness and allowing Jesus to transform us. Do we have that kind of faith?
Thank you, Teresa. That story is often just challenged me to think about it and apply it. You can see, we were just reminded of something of the experience that those disciples went through. It were as a church of thousands of people to a church of 11 and a handful, about the size of what we have here today, probably a little smaller than what we have here today, actually. Ellen White said, before we move on to our final story, Ellen White says something simple, interesting about the experience that the disciples went through here after the feeding of the 5,000. And Jesus speaking to his disciples and saying, are you, that means his closest disciples. He had other disciples, but the closest 11 or 12 disciples, and saying, are you going to leave also? That's a question that tests our faith today. Are you going to leave also? Ellen White says something interesting about that test. She said, had the disciples not gone through that test, this test right here, they would have failed to pass the test when Christ was crucified. Passing this test enabled them to pass the test when Christ was crucified. She said the blow would have been too much. We have one more story to review from a favorite Bible character of mine, and it's a sad story, but there's lessons to be learned, and it's not all sad. Paul, seeing the future by faith. So if you were to visit Rome today, there's a map, may not mean much, but there's a map of the city of Rome, and near the city of Rome, there's a prison called the Mamertine Prison, in which Paul was imprisoned. If you went there today, you could visit that prison. I have a comment for you to think about. This is not the main point of my story, but it's a very sad comment and very important to think about in thinking about the life of the Apostle Paul. Apostle Paul was a martyr for Christ in the mid-60s. That would be the year in the first century. Mid-60s. We're told in Ellen White that it was not God's will for the Apostle Paul to be martyred when he was martyred. That it was not God's will. And that if the church had valued the Apostle Paul and prayed for the Apostle Paul as they should have, and prayed for him as they had prayed for Peter when Peter was in prison, Apostle Paul would have walked out here. So that's something to think when people are going through trouble. Yes, God uses trials to round people out. He does. He uses trials. But let us not think that we're just spectators when somebody is going through a trial. You and I aren't spectators. Our prayers make a difference. They would have made a difference here. It's not the point of the story, but it's a solemn thing to think about. The point of this story is, in Profiles of Faith, I want you to see where the Apostle Paul's faith was as he looked forward to an imminent execution. There's a picture of the prison that he was in, the Mamertine Prison. There's a couple more pictures from the outside. And then as you enter, tradition has it, by the way, that this is a prison that Peter was in before he was finally martyred as well. I'm not sure that's known with as much certainty. And there you can see something of the, on the next slide actually. Now you can see there's a place in the entrance where you can go down. And then you can see something of the cramped and most uncomfortable quarters. You can imagine that when it's cold and wet. And with that man that's in that picture might be seeing more of the prison than the Apostle Paul saw, because I'm sure they have lighting in there. It's a museum now. So the lighting that they didn't have. You can just imagine how uncomfortable that might have been. And then there's just an image on the left. And it's possible that that courtyard in the lower left of the image is the courtyard that Paul was executed in. He was taken outside and executed outside. It is, as you probably already read, it is probable from this prison that Paul urged Timothy to visit him before winter. In fact, if you read that in your Bible, you'll see that Paul's not just asking Timothy to visit him, he's asking him for a coat. He said, please bring the coat I left in Troas. He was cold. Oh, I hate being cold, and when I'm cold in my house, I want to get in the bathtub, you know, and just get all warm. And you can just imagine him being in that situation, and it's hard, and it's cold, and it's damp, and there's no hot bath to get into. Well, what kind of faith did the Apostle Paul have? I have several quotes to read to you about the last part of his life. And I want to take you to where, as best as I can, to where Paul was and what he was looking to as our final profile in faith this morning. Paul carried with him the atmosphere of heaven. All who associated with him felt the influence of his union with Christ. Here lies the power of truth. The unconscious influence of a holy life is the most convincing sermon that can be given in favor of Christianity. Argument, even when unanswerable, may provoke only opposition, but a godly example has a power that it is impossible to wholly resist. The apostle lost sight of his own approaching sufferings in his solicitude for those whom he was about to leave to cope with prejudice, hatred, and persecution. The few Christians who accompanied him, you might recall in that last letter, it's 2 Timothy, that's the Apostle Paul's last letter, it's right before his martyrdom. He said, everyone's left me. And he only mentions one person who, by name, I believe, who was still with him. So she says, few Christians, most Christians had left Paul. He had changed the whole world, and now he's about to die almost alone. The few Christians who accompanied him to the place of execution, he endeavored to strengthen and encourage by repeating the promise given for those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. That's an amazing story about a number of the martyrs. You can read stories of martyrs who are trying to encourage the people that were there supposedly to encourage the martyrs. Maybe there was some mutual encouragement. But here, the Apostle Paul is trying to encourage others to be faithful. For a little season, they might be in weariness through manifold temptations. They might be destitute of earthly comforts, but they could encourage their hearts with the assurance of God's faithfulness, saying, here's again from 2 Timothy, I know whom I have believed, and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him. Soon the night of trial and suffering would end, and then would dawn the glad morning of peace and perfect day. The apostle was looking into the great beyond, not with uncertainty or dread, but with joyous hope and longing expectation. As he stands at the place of martyrdom, he sees not the sword of the executioner or the earth so soon to receive his blood. He looks up through the calm blue heaven of that summer day to the throne of the eternal. This man of faith beholds the ladder of Jacob's vision representing Christ, who has connected earth with heaven. His faith is strengthened. From the rack, the stake, the dungeon, from dens and caves of the earth, there falls upon his ear the martyr's shout of triumph. These, yielding up their lives for the faith, declare to the world that he in whom they have trusted is able to save to the uttermost. Ransomed by the sacrifice of Christ, washed from his sin in his blood, and clothed in his righteousness, Paul has the witness in himself that his soul is precious in the sight of the Redeemer. His life is hid with Christ and God, and he is persuaded that he who conquered death is able to keep that which he has committed to his trust. His mind grasps the Savior's promise, I will raise him up at the last day, John 6:40. By the way, the Gospel of John was yet to be written about 3 decades after this event. So the Apostle Paul is recalling words that he's heard perhaps from John or others. These words that Jesus spoke, I will raise him up at the last day. His thoughts and hopes are centered on the second coming of his Lord. And as the sword of the executioner descends, and the shadows of death gather about the martyr, his latest thought springs forward, as will his earliest in the Great Awakening, to meet the life giver who shall welcome him to the joy of the blessed. That's, you know, that's one place, and it says it here. Ellen White says that our first thoughts when we're raised are the last ones that we died with. We enter life again when we're raised with the last thoughts. Paul's last thought was of seeing his Savior in heaven, and that's what his first thought will be. One more paragraph. Well nigh a score of centuries have passed since Paul the Age poured out his blood as a witness for the world, for the Word of God, and the testimony of Jesus Christ. No faithful hand recorded for the generations to come the last scenes in the life of this holy man. But inspiration has preserved for us his dying testimony. Like a trumpet peal, his voice has rung out through all the ages since, nerving with his own courage thousands of witnesses for Christ, and wakening in thousands of sorrow-stricken hearers the echoes of his own triumphant joy. I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but to all of them, to you, to me, to all who love his appearing. I'm looking forward. I'm praying to be ready, that my faith will match the faith that's needed to see the Apostle Paul. He's become one of my favorite characters in history. But maybe for you, it's not just the Apostle Paul. Maybe it's Dora, or Richard, or another family member, my grandma, for me, whoever it is. It's someone for you that will be looking for you, as well as you looking for them. And I trust that the Holy Spirit has once again invited you to exercise your faith and ask that you be ready for this great day. If so, I'd like to ask that you kneel with me and make this our closing prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for these and so many other profiles of faith. This morning we've just looked at briefly a faith to do the right thing, even though something bad flows from that choice. Our faith extends beyond the circumstances. We've looked at the faith of thousands tested and seen that the vast majority failed the faith test. Well, they kept going to church, but they walked with Jesus no more. We've seen the disciples' faith through that sorely tested. Yet they hung on. Help us to hang on. When the faith of others drops. And we've seen the Apostle Paul. Only you can give the courage. But we've seen Paul exercising the faith. And taking courage and joy right before his martyrdom. And providing for us the words of triumph. In his second letter to Timothy, just before he was martyred. Please make us faithful so that we can see the Apostle Paul again and others who will be looking for us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.